Welcome to Crosstalk here on 90.3 WHPC. I am Rob Leonard. Normally, Steve Mandracino would be with me, but tonight we have a special guest, our first guest ever on Crosstalk, and we're taking a little bit of Steve's show, we're taking a little bit of my show. We have Robin Wilson of the Gin Blossoms joining us.
Yay.
The Gin Blossoms are playing tomorrow, Saturday, the 27th. Of August 2020 over at the Harry Chapin Lakeside Theater.
It's 2022.
I keep saying 2020.
Well, it was such a weird time that it's easy to get stuck there, isn't it?
If we only had a time machine to go back, we'd now know what to do. 2022, yes. I say that so many times. I've been corrected. So thank you for correcting me.
It's my pleasure. If you mess up again, I'm right on top of it.
Please
I promise.
Do. So anyway, Robin's going to play a couple of songs today and at the end of the show to start off Beatles songs. He's going to do a Beatles song too.
Cool.
And we should say you have a special guest guitarist with you who will be singing background vocals. Who is this fine young man?
This fine young man is my son, Gray, who happens to be a DJ here at WHPC. And his show is Alternative to What. It's on Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. And Gray and I have been playing together for his entire life, and so it's good to have him accompanying me. And also his band, The Mercuries, is opening the show at Eisenhower Park tomorrow night.
Oh,
so
wow.
It's always a pleasure to have Gray's band on the bill. They're a fine group of youngsters, and they rock really well. And, you know, it's great for me. You know, I live here on Long Island, and so it's really cool for me to be doing a big free show that all my neighbors and the guys from the hardware store and the car wash and everybody's gets to come to. Because normally if we play here on Long Island, we usually play out at the Paramount. And
right.
It's like a Thursday night, and it's hard to get my nieces and nephews all there. But a big free show on a Saturday night, there's no excuses.
And there's a lot of parking over there at the Paramount. I've been to the Paramount. I like the Paramount, but you got to usually park far away.
Yeah, it's kind of a pain. But, yeah, that's a fun club.
Right.
We usually pack them in, and we played at the Paramount probably 7 or 8 times in the course of our career. So, but this is special, you know. Until recently, I was temporarily living over in Hicksville. I was renting a house over there, and so I spent a lot of time in the last year and a half over at Eisenhower Park.
Right.
And you know, I would walk past, I would go jogging past the Harry Chapin Amphitheater, and be like, I got a feeling that someday I'm gonna play here. And
well, you're the third big act to play this year there. Joan
really?
Jett and the Blackhearts played
great
last month.
Yes.
A band you're familiar with, and we'll talk about this in a couple of minutes, the Smithereens played a few weeks ago.
Yes.
And now it's your turn. So.
And now it's our turn. And so we're going to, you know, we're looking forward to, hopefully we can live up to Joan Jett and the Smithereens. I'm fairly certain we'll be able to pull it off.
Now, you live on Long Island now, as you just said, but you come from Arizona.
Yes, I do. A very different place.
A much different place. Just I'm not even talking about the temperatures, just everything else.
Yes. Roads, grocery stores, like everything's different. You know, the economy's different.
Right.
You know, there's something about Long Island I find interesting. There's a party store every mile you drive on Long Island. I don't know what that is. I don't understand why the economy supports so many party stores. You know, Greek diners. You can't throw a rock without hitting a Greek diner.
That is a specialty.
You know, the grocery stores are full of foods, brands and stuff that we don't have back in Arizona. And, it's very much like it's almost like a different country. But, you know, I've been here pretty much full time for about 15 years.
Oh, wow.
And
okay.
I've been here off and on for since the mid-90s. This is where my ex-wife is from, Gray's mom. And so that's why I'm here, because this is where my son is growing up. So go figure.
Hey, well, why not?
Yeah, it's all right. I mean, I've gotten used to it.
Well, the diners is the best part. Because I mean, you can't explain the diners to outside New York people.
Well,
all you have to say is, well, it's like a Denny's, but they serve you in 5 minutes.
Yeah, it's like a Denny's with a 10-page menu. You know, something about it. And they all have the exact same food. I mean, they don't do anything differently.
Well,
I don't get the whole... I don't understand why they're so prevalent.
They have a big menu. So.
Yeah. But, you know, and Long Island, it took a long time for it to grow on me. And, you know, it really wasn't until the pandemic, when I was stuck at home, that I really finally accepted my fate that I live on Long Island, and you know this is where I'm at. And
well,
I still think of Arizona as my home, but I've grown fond of Long Island. It's taken a while.
Let me say welcome to Long Island.
Thank you, Rob.
Now you're on your 30th anniversary tour for the Gin Blossoms.
Well, the 30th anniversary of New Miserable Experience,
okay.
our major label debut. The band has been together now for 34 years.
Okay, and so what are you doing for your 30th anniversary for this album?
We are going out and doing some shows where we play the entire album.
Is that what's happening on Saturday? Will we
no.
No, okay.
No, that's not,
so
not
only certain
Saturday.
Shows.
Just certain shows. We bill it special as an anniversary show. We do the entire album from beginning to end. And, you know, it's kind of cool. You know, it's a good set. It's thankfully, it's such a solid record. It's the only one of our albums that... where you can play every single song and they all hold up, you know.
Right.
We've made a lot of good records over the years, but New Miserable Experience is definitely the best thing we've ever done, and it's the only one where we could play the entire album from beginning to end and really not lose anybody's interest.
Well, it's a strong album. I mean, when I was going through research, I said, I know all those songs.
Yeah.
So it's and your band fits. I'm trying to figure out where it fits in because it's classic rock, but it's from the 90s, and classic rock's not supposed to be from the 90s, though it sort of now is becoming. It's mm-hmm. not Nirvana. You know, it wasn't really like Nirvana or anything.
No.
That was, so you sort of this pop rock band, which you don't see anymore.
Yeah, well, I think
which I like.
You do actually. There's one of my favorite new groups is called White Reaper, and they play music not all that dissimilar from what we do. But you know, when we started, we thought of ourselves as an alternative band. We were marketed as one, at least at first, and I always thought we were a sort of a cross between the Church and Cheap Trick. I felt like we fell somewhere in there.
Wow,
you know,
that's a good combination.
You know, the Church, they had a lot of really influential songs that definitely had a big impact on Gin Blossoms. And, you know, also groups like R.E.M. You know, we wouldn't be anywhere if it hadn't been for R.E.M. We were swimming in their wake. And the Replacements, they were one of our touchstones when we started the band. That
right.
was someone we looked at and felt like let's try and be like that. But, you know, so I tell people, you know, like cab drivers or just random people that I meet, and they say, well, what kind of band are you? I say, well, we came up in the alternative movement, but with the perspective of time, we're a classic rock band.
Yeah, that's classic rock has changed over the years.
It has. But, you know, I've learned, I worked in record stores all through the 80s, and I've learned that no matter what kind of music you're into, someone is out there doing it as good as it's ever been done. No matter what crazy subgenre you're into, there's somebody out there doing it. It might not be on the radio, it might not be on your radar, but it's out there at all times, no matter what it is. Lesbian bluegrass, Satan metal. There's really not a single subgenre that isn't being represented somewhere. And, you know, radio and popular culture, they go through phases and ride waves and whatnot. But, you know, music is pure, and there's always somebody out there just following their own muse.
This 30th anniversary, is there a special release coming out with this? You know, you go through the archives and find, you know, early versions or late versions or overdubbed versions for your album. Is there any special box set for the 30th anniversary?
No, we did that 5 years ago on the 25th anniversary. So you can still get the vinyl version of the record that's out there, which we released 5 years ago. The only thing special beyond the shows... and the interviews, the only thing special that we're doing to mark the 30th anniversary is a T-shirt that we sell at the gigs. But that's pretty much it, you know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So you want to do a song first? Let's go.
Yeah, why not?
What song are we going to pick? Well, I'll let you pick the first one. And
well, you know, since Gray was little, he's been playing along with me on this number. This was a big hit for Jim Blossoms, an important moment in our career.
Well, before you start, when Gray was little, do you remember, like, the first time he's saying, As a kid, what are you doing? I mean, you know, you're making music. You're making noise with that piece of wood.
What? Well, from when he was a baby, there was always guitars, and I was always playing around the house. But he used to come to the shows when he was a baby. We would bring his little toy guitars, and he would get on stage with the band with his toy guitar, and he would do the devil horns, and he would rile up the crowd, and he really thought he was in the band, and he was actually playing an instrument. And there's a lot of great photographs of Gray when he was little on stage with Jim Blossoms. And so he grew up with the band. My bandmates are his uncles, and we're all just one big family. So
okay.
Anyway, Gray's been playing on this one. As I said, this was an important moment for the band. This is called Till I Hear From You.
Let's do this.
Come on.
They shouldn't have told me. At first I laughed, but now it's sinking in fast. Whatever they've sold me. Well, baby, I don't want to take advice from fools. I'll just figure everything is cool till I hear it from you. It gets hard, the memories faded. Who gets what they say? It's likely they're just jealous and jaded. Well, maybe I don't want to take advice from fools. I'll just figure everything is cool till I hear it from you. Till I hear it from you. I can't let it get me off or break up my train of thought. Far as I know, nothing's wrong till I hear it from you. Outside looking in till we're talking about not stepping around it. Maybe I don't want to take advice from fools. I'll just figure everything is cool till I hear it from you. 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 Whoa, no. Till I hear it from you.
I think it
Here we go.
Beautiful, beautiful. I always wait till the fade ends, just in case you ever want to use it for something.
Yeah, that was great. Nice work, Jerry.
Cool,
thank you.
Very
good
cool.
Job. Good job.
Now the Mercury's Gray's band, they're getting paid tomorrow, right? You know, they're not just up there because your dad.
They're actually getting paid
right.
Twice what we used to get paid opening for Toad the Wet Sprocket.
Wow.
It's decent money, you know, considering it's not enough to live on, but you know.
Hey. Better than what I'm making.
Yeah, they're doing all right. They're doing okay. They're a really talented band too. They are very good.
I've seen some of the stuff on YouTube.
Yeah, they've got good original material, a lot of high energy and stuff. And
I like the name Mercury's. I don't think anyone's ever used it. It's like people go through cars and they go through street signs and no one's going up on Mercury.
I wonder, Gray, is it? What is the inspiration behind the name? Is it the planet, or is it the singer Freddie Mercury, or the automobile?
Or the god Mercury.
The name Freddie Mercury is the biggest influence.
Yeah.
But to tell you the truth, I didn't come up with the name. It was my mom.
Oh, okay.
You see, originally, me and some of the guys in the Mercury's were in another band called The Riffs. And so we tried coming up with a different name that was super cool, super simple, easy to remember, and had the something, you know, the Beatles, the Who, the Clash, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So my mom, out of nowhere, said, how about the Mercury's? And it took a little bit of time for it to grow on me, but it worked.
Yeah.
And I introduced it to the others, and they like it. So that's our name.
Do you do any Queen stuff in your act?
Well,
if you're named after him, you got to do a couple of songs.
I could if I had Freddie Mercury's vocal range, I don't.
Not everybody does. Neither do I. But
not even Dave Grohl can sing like him.
Yeah. No, that's true. Now, mm-hmm. Robin, you're
besides
doing the Gin Blossoms thing, sometimes I see on the Smithereens site that you're their lead singer.
I do get to sing part-time for the Smithereens, one of my all-time favorite bands, and I'm very excited to announce that we are going to be performing as the Smithereens in my hometown, Tempe, Arizona, on October 21st of this year.
No.
So I'm super excited to get to front the Smithereens in my hometown. That's going to be really awesome. Yeah.
Now, I know Marshall Crenshaw has been playing a lot with them,
mm-hmm.
but when he's not there, you're there. How did that happen? I mean, I know why, you know, Pat. It starts with Pat DiNizio, sadly, dying, and I had interviewed him a couple of times, and he was a great interview.
Mm-hmm.
But how did you get to be the backup lead singer, so to speak, of the Smithereens?
Well, I was asked to appear in a tribute concert for Pat DiNizio a few months after his passing, and I was tasked with singing a couple of songs, and
right.
so I was ready to do a couple of tunes, and then that day, somebody else didn't show up, and I got a call in my hotel room, and they're like, hey, can you do Blood and Roses? And I'm like, you're damn right I can do Blood and Roses. And they're like, well, can you do Behind the Wall of Sleep? And I'm like, yeah, I got this. And so I showed up, and I kicked butt all over the stage, and the guys and I, we just really hit it off. I had met Pat several times in the course of my life, but I didn't really know the other guys. And they at first were somewhat reluctant to even have me participate in the tribute show because they didn't really know me.
Right.
But one of their girlfriends was like, no, definitely get this guy involved. And like I say, we hit it off. And at the end of the night, I went into their dressing room and I said, I would love to do this some more. I would love to sing for you guys. And I don't think it had even occurred to them at that point. They were still just a few months after Pat's passing, I don't think that they had really even considered like replacing him and going
right.
on. And there was just this sort of light in their eyes when I said that. And, it just worked out. And I'll tell you, it is such a thrill for me to get to sing those tunes and to work with those guys. They're absolutely fabulous dudes. It's an incredible body of work. It's some of my all-time favorite music, and it's just it's an honor to
right.
to fill in for Pat, And as a singer, it's a lot easier than what I do in Gym Blossoms, because in Gym Blossoms, I'm at the very top of my range on half of the songs. The Smithereens, they lower the key on everything. They play everything a half step low. And so as a vocalist, physically, it's pretty easy for me to sing it. The big difference and the real challenge is the lyrics. There seems to be about twice as many words per song in a Smithereens tune as there are in a Jim Blossom song. So it has thousands and thousands of words to memorize.
Right.
And, you know, I was really familiar with the tunes, but until I actually joined the group, I didn't have to go through the process of really memorizing every lyric. And it's a lot of work. But fortunately, that part of my brain is pretty well tuned.
So. Now, you, Marshall Crenshaw, who normally sings with him when you don't, you and him have written a song while ago.
Yeah, the one we just played,
yeah,
Till
so,
I Hear From You.
How did that come about? I mean, were you guys in the same room? Were you, you know, did you finish something off? Did he finish something off? How did that work out?
The song started with our guitar player, Jesse Valenzuela. He came up with the basic concept of the song. As far as I know, he and Marshall were never in a room together,
right.
But I believe he sent Marshall a demo, and then Marshall worked his magic and sort of changed the chords and sort of rearranged the chorus, came up with the chords for the bridge and things like that. So Marshall added a touch of melody that wasn't there before. And then they handed it over to me, and I had to write virtually all of the lyrics. The only lyrics that were written was the chorus.
Right.
And so it fell to me to write lyrics for the verses and for the bridge. And it was a great challenge, and I just work backwards as a songwriter. When I'm given a chorus, I have to take the theme as I see it and create the rest of the narrative around it. And so I kind of work backwards, and I try to find out, okay, what would you say just before you get to the chorus? How do you lead the story to that moment? And, I remember working on the song because it was going to be on a movie soundtrack, and the whole our label was waiting for it, and the movie producers were waiting for it, and there was all this pressure on me to do it. And I remember thinking to myself, all I have to do is not F this up. And I just focused, and, you know, I reached inside, and I wrote some lyrics.
Well, that's how some of the best lyrics are written. You know, there's a place it's going, there's a time limit, and you, like you said, you don't want to F it up.
Yeah, that's all I had to do, is just not screw up this beautiful palette that they had laid out for me. And it went on to be one of our biggest tunes, and we've always had this connection to Marshall. We've been friends with him ever since.
Right.
And often he's joined us on stage. If he's nearby, he'll come out and play guitar on that tune. And, you know, I was always a fan of his.
Right.
One of his records was always one of my favorites, Mary Jean and Nine Others, just a fantastic album that was produced by Don Dixon, who also did The Smithereens. It's really awesome.
Right.
And I'm very fortunate for the career that I've had.
Let's hear another song live in the studio.
Okay.
What song are we going to hear?
This was on the last record, Mixed Reality. And actually, on the recording, Gray plays the tambourine on that on that recording. And I remember I brought him into the studio for a weekend. He was only 16 at the time.
No, I was 15.
15.
I told Don and Mitch, my kid's going to play tambourine on this track. And apparently we left the room, and they looked at each other and said, okay, we'll just record it, but we'll re-record it later when the kid's not around. And Gray just nailed the tambourine track for the song, of course, and because he's my kid, you know.
Of course.
So anyway, this is from our album Mixed Reality, which was produced by Don Dixon, recorded by Mitch Easter, and this is a song I wrote called Break.
You can always hope that somehow you can rise above empty bottles and regrets always piling up. We don't always want what's easy, never is enough. Not what I set out to be, but more than what I was, and I won't break. I won't let it break my heart. as ghosts, looking out from under shadow, blinded by the sun, with my eyes wide shut, I stare and soak it up, and I won't break. I won't let it break my heart. I crawl out from under custom love, I fall and rise above, and I won't break. Hey. I crawl out from under custom love, I fall and rise above, and I won't break. I won't break. Hey.
That song.
Thank you very much. Yeah, and on the recording, Mitch Easter plays the guitar solo that's at the very, very end of the song after the reprise. So it was cool to have Gray play tambourine, to have Mitch Easter on a track. Don Dixon plays keyboards on the record. It was really an awesome experience.
Very cool.
Man, did I prove them wrong?
Yes, you proved them wrong. They were very impressed when you started doing that. And then we also, Gray, we all did hand claps on a couple of numbers where we were in the studio, me and Don and Mitch and Gray, all doing hand claps together. So
we are talking with Robin Wilson, sorry.
Hey, that's right.
Robin Wilson the Gin Blossoms, as the Gin Blossoms are playing the Harry Chapin Lakeside Theater. I thought I was gonna. I said to myself, I'm going to say that. I know. But
yeah, you got
tomorrow.
Psych yourself up.
August 27th, 2022.
Yeah.
And it's a free show, so get there early. And,
yeah.
The parking sometimes can be a problem, but it's Eisenhower Park, so it's a nice place to park. Like I said, the band's been around for a long time. You actually broke up for a little bit, but if you think about it, you guys were only broken up for a small period of time.
Yeah.
Most bands now take a 4-year break between records. So
right.
So when you guys decided to come back, what was going through your mind about your other bandmates? Because let's be honest, sometimes you can play in a band and it works out great, and as soon as you stop playing, that's when things start to get crazy.
Yeah. It was definitely a weird period when we were apart. We were apart for 5 years. You know, we all stayed in touch, but we were all doing different projects. And, you know, the whole time we were together, or we were apart, you know, we were getting offers to play as Jim Blossoms. And, you know, I was trying really hard to break my other band. I was in a group called Gas Giants, and I was doing everything I could to establish a new identity with that band. And then the Gas Giants fell apart for all the same stupid reasons that Jim Blossoms did. You know, just it's really difficult to keep a band together. And once you have a success like Jim Blossoms, there's really no excuse not to keep it together. You know, we came back together in the early 2000s, and it was our bass player Bill, who has always been sort of the wisest, and he's the anchor of the band. And Bill said that each of us are allowed to have our own Jim Blossoms experience. And it's everybody in the band has the right to do it the way they want to do it. And so we just agreed to just shut up and do our jobs and keep it together and help each other as a family to put all our kids through college, you know. And so the 2000s were a tough time for the band, because when we broke up at the very height of our fame, then the music industry just like completely changed in the 5 years that we were apart. There were all these mergers and Napster, and just everything changed. And when we came back, we were in a lot of ways forgotten. And so we had to start at the bottom of the touring industry, doing a lot of crappy gigs and playing just all free shows, all soft ticket dates, and a lot of like lower tier festival work and stuff, and a lot of auto dealership parking lots and just mercenary work like that. That was really not very dignified. But we just kept at it. We rebuilt our fan base, and then by the 2010s, we were selling more tickets. We went out on a couple of package tours with our friends in Sugar Ray, and we just kicked butt all over those tours, and we were getting great press, and it's just we've been on the rise ever since. And go figure, now we sell more tickets and more merchandise than we ever have in the entirety of our career. So we're at an all-time high, and nobody in the band could have seen that coming 34 years ago.
Right. And you're the lead singer, but does any other bandmate say, "Hey, I want to sing too," and, you know, "I want to sing more," or "I want to write more"?
You know,
how does that work?
We've all settled into our roles, and, you know, Jesse Valenzuela is a fantastic singer, and he sings background on virtually every tune. He and Scotty Johnson trade off the guitar solos. It's a very democratic situation. What's most important to us is that everyone in the group be represented as a songwriter, and that we support each other's songwriting. That's the key. And so I show up, and it takes a long time to find the strength to put your own ego aside and just be there all the time to support your bandmates no matter what song they bring in. But that's the way I approach it now, you know. And some songs are better than others, but I give it my all when I'm learning one of my bandmate songs, and then we see where it all evolves and what ends up on the record. And then once we have a record, there's a whole nother process to figure out which of those songs are going to end up in the live show.
Right.
And we'll try a bunch of stuff out, and some survive and some don't. And, you know, a lot of this is unspoken. You know, we don't have to sit down and have a meeting about specifically what songs are working and what are not. We can sort of just feel it, and we know each other well enough to sort of intuit that, you know. But as I say, everybody in the band is represented as a songwriter. That's really key. And there's no one in the group that has any more authority than anybody else. I think maybe Jesse might have the sort of a default leadership role, and I do too, you know, for different reasons. But my vote doesn't count any more than Bill or Scotty's. It's a true democracy.
So you figured out how to stay together and not kill each other as musicians, but at the same time,
you know you
have something good, and you have to stay together.
Yes, shut up and do your job, and be grateful that people want to come and see you play. You know, that's the attitude. If you're gonna survive for 34 years, eventually you will end up with that philosophy.
Right. I always think of the Who. You know, they're still going as the Who, and they put out a record a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But then you find out that Roger just sang on it. Pete did all the music, and but they figured out how to do it. And that's something you have to do. The same with the Stones. They figured out how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
We are talking with Robin Wilson of the Gin Blossoms, as tomorrow at the Harry Chapin Lakeside Theater, the Gin Blossoms will be doing a free show. That doesn't mean they're not getting paid. They're generous people over there.
We don't really do anything for free.
But they will be paid. So if you're worried about Robin living out on the street or something, no, it's okay. He's written a couple of good songs, and guess what? He's making money from them too.
I'll be okay.
And the opening band will be the Mercuries, which is your son's band, and your son has been playing with you, Gray Wilson, and he also, for those who don't know, does a fine radio show here at 90.3 WHPC called Alternative. Well, no, what's it called again?
Alternative to what?
Alternative to what?
Tuesday nights at 7 p.m.
That's right.
Okay. I named it Alternative to What because people always ask, what exactly is alternative music? Is it alternative to rock? Is it alternative to pop? Is it alternative to punk? If you think about it, alternative is basically just a really broad genre that combines a whole bunch of genres.
Right. But
that's the way I look at it anyway.
But every 5 years or so, music writers have to come up with a new name. It's all, as Billy Joel said, it's still rock and roll to me. So, anyway, we're going to do one more song because this was only supposed to be like a 15-minute interview. We've already done about 45. So we're going to do one more song as it leads into Beatles songs.
All right. Very cool. Well, my favorite album, my favorite Beatles record has always been Rubber Soul. So.
Beautiful.
It's a good one.
So we're gonna do I'm Looking Through You. Rob, thank you for having us on.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it. Looking forward to the show tomorrow at Eisenhower Park, and to all of my friends and family here on Long Island. Wish you all well, and hope to see you there at the show.
Yeah.
All right, this is the Beatles. I'm Looking Through You. Whoops. There it is.
I'm looking through you, where did you go? I thought I knew you, what did I know? You don't look different, but you have changed. I'm looking through you, you're not the same. You're thinking of me same old way. You were above me, but not today. The only difference is you're down there. I'm looking through you, but you're nowhere. Why, tell me, why did you not treat me right? Nasty habit of disappearing overnight. You're thinking of me the same old way. You were above me, but not today. The only difference is you're down there. I'm looking through you, but you're nowhere. Tell me, why did you not treat me right? Love has a nasty habit of disappearing overnight. I'm looking through you, where did you go? I thought I knew.